Welcome, everybody. Today, we are celebrating our dear friend, Fred Taylor. His life, his legacy, and the release of his memoir, What and Give Up Showbiz? 6 decades in the music business. This tribute is a benefit event for the Fred Taylor Endowed Scholarship at the Berklee College of Music. Now, to kick things off is my dear friend, President Roger Brown from Berklee College of Music.
Welcome, everybody. It's great to be back together honoring Fred Taylor. He can bring us all together no matter what. And we're also honoring the release of his book called What and Give Up Showbiz. I've read my copy, and it's really wonderful. You sort of feel like you're in the green room with Fred after a show, just going over the highlights of his entire show, his entire life. And the thing that comes through so clearly is just how much he loved to discover a young artist and help that person on their way in quiet, subtle ways that made a huge difference for so many. And also how often when an established artist needed a lift or a change of scene, they would come to Fred and he would help them figure out how to take the next step in their careers. Truly a remarkable story about a remarkable man who just loved the music and the musicians so deeply and took so much joy and also, you know, was behind the scenes and totally happy and delighted to be there. I strongly encourage that you read it. We're honored at Berklee to have a scholarship in Fred's name that Grace Kelly and her family and many generous musicians helped us create so that young artists can get the chance to study music in the name of Fred and continue that great legacy and great tradition. Next on the roster is one of those musicians who Fred helped along the way, Berklee alumna, brilliant pianist and vocalist Diana Krall, who's going to offer her tribute to Fred. So please welcome Diana and have a great evening.
It's wonderful. It's marvelous that you should care for me. It's awful nice. It's paradise. It's what I love to see. Glamorous. You can't blame me for feeling amorous. It's wonderful, marvelous that you should care for me. It's wonderful. It's marvelous that you should care for me. It's awful nice. It's paradise. It's what I love to see. From now on, my heart's looking over time. It's wonderful, marvelous that you should care for me. wonderful. It's marvelous that you should care for me. It's awful nice. It's paradise. It's what I love to see. You made my life so glamorous. You can't blame. Marvelous that you should care for me.
Thank you, Diana Krall, for that beautiful rendition of one of Fred's favorite jazz standards. It's wonderful. Oh, it's just so lovely. And stay tuned for yet another rendition of that song a little bit later. Fred had been a fan of Diana Krall since her early days performing at the Boston Harbor Hotel and was influential in her early career. I remember the day I got to perform in front of Fred Taylor at Scholars Jazz Club. I was performing and sitting in with the wonderful singer-songwriter Ann Hampton Calloway. I was playing the song Somewhere Over the Rainbow, and after the performance he came up to me and he said, "That was beautiful and I'd like you to do something at the club." I was absolutely floored. This is a moment I had dreamed of. I was 13 years old, and soon after that, he booked me to bring my band to Scholars Jazz Club and play my very first professional club gig at that legendary venue. Words cannot express how incredible that moment was to me. Fred always had a song, a joke, a story to go with every moment. And I remember his wonderful napkin trick that would make its way to our Thanksgiving dinner parties, and his warmth, his positivity, and his love would just always make me smile and would make everyone around him feel so welcome. If you knew him personally, you know exactly what I'm talking about, right? I am so grateful to Fred Taylor for believing in me since I was 13 years old, for introducing me to people in the music business, opening doors for me, allowing my artistry to get out to the world, and for always being there to support me. And he really became family. I miss him so dearly and think about him often. Fred, miss and love you so much. The song you are about to hear is an original composition of mine called Feels Like Home. It's a song that I wrote for my boyfriend, and it was Fred's favorite song of mine.
Suddenly I'm falling 1,000 stories high. It's amazing and it's crazy, and I'm strangely satisfied. You grab my hand and the colors in my world come alive. But I never planned to fall in love. We watch the hours and the sunlight run away, talking of dreams, childhood memories, and family holidays. You were a stranger, then a lover, now something more I cannot say. Maybe this time it could be love. 'Cause you feel feel like smile so bright, you feel like home. See it coming, but this time I'm not running. You feel like home when I look into your eyes. Your kisses taste like sunshine. You turn me on so bright. You feel like home. You feel like home.
Feel like home.
On a starlit summer night. You're the drumbeat of my heart. Your loving red eyes wine. Oh, you feel like home. You feel like home.
Next up is the amazing Esperanza Spalding with a personal message and song. Esperanza and I have something in common, thanks to Fred. We were both introduced to the national jazz audience thanks to Fred's curation at the Tanglewood Jazz Cafe in our teens and early 20s. Tanglewood's Jazz Cafe was Fred's idea. He started the Tanglewood Jazz Fest back in 2001 by the request of Boston Symphony Orchestra and was the artistic director until 2007. In his second year, he came up with the idea of the Tanglewood Jazz Cafe to introduce and showcase young performers including Rachel Price, Taylor Eichsti, Julian Lage, and Warren Wolf. As Fred says in his book, Tanglewood Jazz Festival was one of his greatest achievements.
This is coming from my heart to the spirit of Fred Taylor, wherever you're roaming now, sending so much gratitude for your belief in me, for seeing me, inviting me into so many performance spaces and really treating me like a professional as I was budding into a band leader, performer, composer. It really, really meant so much. So pray that the spirit of Fred Taylor is roaming somewhere, hearing all the good music and feeling this wave of love emanating towards him tonight. Thank you, Fred. Thank you, Fred. Thank you, Fred.
Not to worry, never mind, life will fix it every time. Make a balance, feel a need, bring a flower from a seed.
It wasn't you invented sin. Shake your shoulders, do a dance. Never mind the sad romance. A time has come, a corner turn.
In 2017, Fred was in the front row watching the All-Star Benefit Concert, which established the endowed scholarship at Berklee College of Music in his name. He was moved to tears even from the sound check. And believe me, come showtime, the artists, the audience, we were all in tears. It was a love fest. It was a beautiful love fest celebrating our dear friend. Tonight marks the very first time we are sharing video highlights from the All-Star Concert. If you'd like to watch the full concert, check out the link in the description below.
We are at the Jazz Workshop down on Boylston Street in Boston. The band, Herbie Hancock's new band.
This is WBCN in Boston. This is B.B. King. Get down with it.
All right.
Performing tonight with Bill Jackson?
Well, the trio behind you.
Miles Davis looking resplendent in a sort of red or orange type of outfit.
We're at the Jazz Workshop at 733 Boylston Street, and we'll be bringing you Donald Byrd.
Here I am, and Keith is down at the piano.
Charlie Hayden on bass.
And I'm a marble boy who wants.
the Fred Taylor Scholarship Fund Berklee All-Star Jazz Concert. Please welcome your swinging hosts, Grace Kelly, and here and now is Robin Young.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the All-Star Tribute to Freddie Taylor, the hippest man in show business, and we are not Freddie talking about those replacements. Thank you very much. You can go. How about a thank you to this young lady whose idea was to have this fabulous concert and establish a scholarship for a Berklee student, Grace Kelly.
Thank you so much. Thank you all. Who's excited? Oh my gosh, guys, I am so excited, and what an honor and a thrill to be here with the one and only Robin Young. So first things first, thank you all for being here for the one and only, all of our friend, the amazing Fred Taylor.
You may have seen our next performer on American Idol, or singing Baby It's Cold Outside with Lyle Lovett on Jay Leno, or in the role of Kathmandu with Garrison Keillor on his Guy Noir series on Prairie Home Companion, or as the Les Tropiques nightclub singer in Woody Allen's Cafe Society, or playing around the world backing her own three albums. Please welcome singer, songwriter, Kat Edmonson.
Thank you. How about Bo Winiker? James Dale and Tim Ray.
Silent, I remember why.
A very special man on piano. I'm going to give him a formal introduction a little bit later. I feel like I'm kind of giving him away a little bit early, but I asked him if he would play on this next song with me because he is a legend on the piano, and I have been so blessed to get to work with him in the past. He recorded on an album I made with my mentor, Phil Woods, and then later brought me to his jazz festival, and last year invited me to perform with him when he was celebrating 100 years of Frank Sinatra's birthday and curating a beautiful program at Rose Hall in New York City. Please say hello to Mr. Monty Alexander on piano, everybody. We're gonna do a song for you, which was the first song that I played in front of Fred Taylor. When I was 14 years old, I got invited up to sit in with Ann Hampton Calloway at Scholars Jazz Club. And I played this song, and afterwards he came up to me and said, I wanna book your band here. And my jaw was on the ground. James Dale, Mark Walker. I gotta say, before I bring on this next featured artist, I'm fangirling so hard by all these musicians. This is so... I don't usually do this, introducing people, but I'm having a lot of fun. I hope you guys are too. So this next performer, whether she's performing with Herbie Hancock, Wayne Shorter, Al Jarreau, drummer, producer, arranger, everything-er, such an inspiration to me. And she was also, in 2013, the very first woman to win a Jazz Instrumental Award from the Grammy Awards. And I've been very honored over the years to have met her when I was originally 13, and she brought me up on stage, and she's been an amazing mentor, and we're gonna bring her on out here. Please give it up for the wonderful Terri, Lyne, Carrington.
Thank you, Grace, for that great introduction. I didn't make the video cut, but I want to... But I want to take a moment and thank Fred Taylor for everything. Goodness, I've known this man since I was, I don't know, about nine years old. And I used to go to the Paul's Mall and the Jazz Workshop as a kid and sit in with so many great artists. And it really catapulted my career at a very young age. So he was very instrumental. So I'd like to say thank you for all of those opportunities, all the shows that you let me and my father and my mother in for free. Thank you. Gosh, playing with B.B. King and Grover Washington Jr. and Paul's Mall and Rahsaan Roland Kirk and Art Farmer and Elvin Jones and Roy Haynes at the Jazz Workshop and so many other people. These are memories and just part of my history that I'll never, ever forget. So we'd like to play something, dedicate this song to you. It's a song from my last CD. It's called The Mosaic Project, Love and Soul. The great Natalie Cole sang it on the CD. And I feel like Grace giving away all these great musicians. But we'd like to also welcome Kurt Elling. Okay. This is a sneak preview of Kurt, and also a sneak preview of the great Danilo Perez. Danilo and John are like my brothers. The great John Patitucci on bass. And to my left, incredible trumpeter, Jason Palmer, our musical director. This is Come Sunday. Thank you.
Just being like, we both said this is one of the best nights of music we've ever experienced. Wow. Mind blown.
For a couple thoughts about Freddie Taylor, it's kind of like an intermission, except we're making you stay. Especially the students here, did you know that Freddie Taylor discovered Diana Krall when she was a Berklee student? She was working in an area hotel, and a guy came up to Freddie with this old cassette. It's a thing with tape in it. And Freddie started booking her at Scullers, and Freddie said at the time, I thought this gal should sing more. She's got a fetching voice. You think? Thank you, Fred Taylor. I was working at WBUS before public radio and WBUR, doing sort of a hybrid music interview show, and I would get these trademark Freddie Taylor calls. I've been getting them for decades. In the 70s, it was, you gotta listen to this, you gotta hear this girl. And the name of the segment on Evening Magazine was 11-year-old drummer Terri Lyne Carrington. I got another call a few years ago, and the segment on NPR was 14-year-old saxophonist Grace Kelly. But this, you gotta hear this, was in the mid-90s. And what Freddie had was an old beat-up cassette that somebody had given him, and it was the late Eva Cassidy's Over the Rainbow. And he said, you gotta play this. And we played it on BOS. It broke the phones. It broke her nationally. Freddie and I were in Time and Newsweek. Very exciting. Ultimately, her family was able to put out 14 CDs of Eva Cassidy's material. She died way too young of cancer, and it had all been recorded, but it had never gone anywhere. And because of Freddie Taylor saying, you gotta hear this, you gotta hear this, Eva Cassidy became the star after her death that she should have been. Thank you, Freddie Taylor. In 2010, the Jazz Journalists Association, these are 400 journalists nationwide, named Fred Taylor one of the 5 jazz heroes of 2010, citing his big ears. And what they meant is that he heard things that other people didn't hear, but he also helped you with your dreams. When I was at BOS, I had this bucket list, and it was like, well, what do I want? Well, how about Brian Wilson playing with the Beach Boys again? I mean, he only hasn't played with them in 2 decades. Freddie, can you book Brian Wilson into Symphony Hall for his first appearance with the Beach Boys? Yes, he could. And we sold it out, and it started a whole new chapter for Brian Wilson, who, when Freddie contacted him, I think I have this right, said, well, who wants to hear me? Started a whole new chapter. Same with Jimmy Webb, one of the great songwriters of all time, Wichita Lyman, I mean, come on. He thought he was washed up, and Fred and I thought otherwise. Freddie Bush booked him for 2 shows at Scullers. Now, Jimmy was glorious in the first show. Oh, he sang Galveston, and by the time I get to Phoenix, and Adios, and Moon's a Harsh Mistress. Told stories about Glenn Campbell, it was wonderful. In the second show, he was drunk and snarling, and I actually think he said, F you, Linda Ronstadt, I think. It's one of those times when you're looking over at Freddie, he goes, what, and leave show business? That's the other thing about Freddie, though. He is the only one who can work with talent and some of the difficulties that come with talent. After that show at Scullers, Jimmy Webb got sober, he got married, he got a whole new chapter in his life, and every time I interview him, he says, hey, have you said thank you to Fred Taylor? From Jimmy Webb. So, He relaunched artists, as we've been hearing all night, he also launched them. Many of you saw an unknown Billy Joel play Paul's Mall by candlelight during the Great Northeast Blackout. I saw Bruce Springsteen back up David Bromberg. I mean, were you there? And I also remember a magical night at the Jazz Workshop. Gary Burton Quintet, Roy Haynes on drums, Steve Swallow bass, and this kid in a striped shirt and long hair, God, he was cute, and he could play guitar. He went on to form his own groups, play solo, score films, cure cancer, no kidding. He's won 92 Grammy Awards, no, I think it's 20, the only person to win them in 10 categories. Now, he tours so much, and this is something for you students to hear, he tours so much now that he has to take a couple weeks off at a time to rest those precious paws. But Pat Metheny so wanted to be here tonight to say something about Freddie Taylor. Please welcome Pat Metheny.
Thank you. Thank you. You know, I wrote all this stuff and I realized I'm not gonna use it at all, so. I'm just gonna talk. It's so inspiring to be here. To hear the music and the way that it reflects on the love that all of us have for Fred. It's you know, it's in a weird time in the world right now. But you know, it's always been weird. It's never been great. People always say, oh, it must have been great then. You know, it's always been difficult. It's always been difficult for Fred to do what he's done. It never was easy. And, you know, I remember talking with Roy Haynes, maybe, you know, one of those nights at the, you know, wherever we were playing together, and it's like, man, it must have been great back then, and, you know, on 52nd Street, he was like, no, it's a drag. Everybody was talking and smoking, and, you know, it was like, wow, really? You were playing with Bird, and Art Tatum was the, you know, intermission piano player? Oh, man, you know. So it's never been easy, and particularly for, you know, the business side of what it is to be a musician. You know, honestly, and this is probably true for you young guys too, you don't really think about that too much when you're practicing and you're in the shed trying to, you know, figure out how to play and everything. But in the back of your mind, you have this idea, I think, okay, I'm gonna do this at some point in front of a whole bunch of people. But the mechanism of how that works is actually, at least for me, it was something I never really thought about that much. Like, there's gonna be an audience that I hoped, maybe there'd be a few people would come, but how did they get there and how's this all gonna work? And as Robin mentioned, when I started, it was, you know, I was young, I was 18, 19 years old when I started playing with Gary Burton. And, you know, for me, that was already like joining the Beatles. That was like the gig of my dreams. If I had never done anything except be in Gary's band for a year or two, I would have died happy. That was plenty for me. One of the early gigs that we did was playing at the Jazz Workshop. And early in the week, Fred, who obviously, you know, I knew about because I was a fan and was there all the time hearing everybody that we've all talked about, came up and, you know, was complimentary. And I was kind of taken aback by how closely he was listening to what I was playing. And there was this sort of thing like, you know, maybe when you're ready, you might get to play here. And, you know, actually knowing that this guy had heard so much music and, you know, there's a thing that happens when you play a lot with great musicians that really musicians almost are the only ones that know. When you're standing next to Roy Haynes or Gary or, you know, Danilo or, you know, Terri Lyne, when you hear them once and it's amazing, but when you get to hear somebody like 10 nights in a row, you have a whole different perspective. And that's something that musicians are very lucky about. And there aren't too many other people that have that same connection. And Fred, of course, he's there every night. He's the guy, the first person there, the last person to leave. Many, I would say by far, most people that are you know, club owners are not necessarily checking out the music the same way Fred does, because Fred loves the music. And for me, that moment of him talking to me and saying, you know, maybe someday you might get to play here, you know, as a leader or whatever, it was like, wow, you know. That was, you know, really something, you know, I hadn't gotten that far in my mind. I was just trying to hang on falling grace and not mess up the changes with Gary or whatever. It was like, wow, this could be that. And, you know, a year or two later, over four or five times of playing at the workshop with Gary, you know, Fred was always really nice with me, very curious about things. I was playing a lot of gigs around town in other places at that time, with Bob Moses, great drummer, and my friend from and my friend from Florida, who nobody had ever heard of at that time, Jaco Pastorius. I used to bring him up, and the three of us would play gigs at, you know, little clubs in Somerville and all over the place for the door for a dollar person. We'd split up the bread at the end, and after we paid for Jocko's plane fare, which was about $30 then, you know, Fred said, hey, I see you've been playing these gigs around town. And I'm like, yeah, you know. And he said, well, and right about that time, I had recorded my first record, and it was going to come out. And, you know, officially the gesture was made, you know, can you play a week at the workshop with that band? And really, that was, for me, even though I'd played a lot of gigs with Gary, played, you know, with gigs of my own, that was really like kind of getting called up from the minors to, you know, play against the Yankees at Fenway Park. I mean, really, that was the moment where it was like, okay, you know. And we did our week, and I think we did okay. I can't remember exactly, but I've been doing gigs with Freddie ever since, and that's now, I don't know, 42 years that we've been doing stuff together. And, you know, he's truly one of the great people. He's one of the great people. And this weird time that we live in, this culture of whatever it is that's going on, to me, there are standards that have been set along the way that it represent a certain kind of currency that is true. And it's the currency of good notes. It's the currency of honesty and all the things that this music represents. And there's a musical version of that, but there's a kind of cultural infrastructure that allows that to happen that can only exist with people like Fred, and him in particular. All of us that are here would not have had the platform to develop our whatever it is that we have put our hearts and souls into, the research of making that particular sound happen, without opportunities like what Fred has given us to do our thing. So from all of us, Fred, we love you so much, and thank you for the chance to play. And with that, I'd like to bring Fred Taylor to the stage.
You know, while I'm sitting there, I'm saying, who is this guy that they're talking about? But it's kind of wonderful to think about. I happen to be an only child, and I don't have any sisters or brothers, and I didn't get married. By the way, they ask you, how come you never got married? So I always tell them, well, nobody ever asked me. But to think that after I am gone, that there is a legacy that will help keep the music going, and that is such an incredibly great thing. So I think without any further ado, here she comes.
Fred Taylor, everybody, we're gonna take a moment just to take a picture. We have a lot more music. Are you guys having a good time? Can we take a picture with all the artists?
Absolutely.
Everybody. Everybody, hashtag those photos on Facebook and Instagram.
Hey Fred, I'm in New York City and I can't be with you tonight, but I wanted you to hear it right from me. Thank you, thank you, thank you for doing all that you have done over the years for our music, jazz music. You've been incredible. As a matter of fact, I remember 30 years ago, you booked me as the opening act for the great Al Jarreau. I never thought I'd get an opportunity like that, and it was all because of you. And I even remember you driving me around from radio station to radio station at all hours of the day and night. You were an inspiration to me and an instrumental part in my career. I can't thank you enough, Fred. God bless you.
Thank you.
up is the legendary jazz impresario George Wein, National Endowment of the Arts Jazz Master, founder of the Newport Jazz Festival, among many other ventures. George is a longtime friend and collaborator of Fred Taylor's for over 70 years, starting from the early 1950s. Fred was a longtime fan of the Newport Jazz Festival. You'd often find him hanging out, watching music, greeting the artists, at the media and press tent. It was one of his favorite festivals, and he never missed it. I am so grateful for Fred for introducing me to George Wein and getting to perform at the Newport Jazz Fest 7 different times, including my first time opening for Jamie Cullum in 2010. I'll never forget that moment. I came off stage. George Wein was side stage and he said to me, I loved your singing. You should do more of that. It's a memory I will always cherish and hold close to my heart.
I can't wait to read Freddie's book. Freddie was part of my life. Right from way at the beginning in Storyville in the 50s in Copley Square. He had the brains to tape record Dave Brubeck, and Dave loved what he recorded and put it out in an album, one of the best solos Dave ever played. Freddie was there all the time. He helped keep jazz alive in Boston for years, and he represents what many people are in the country that love jazz and devote their life to it, even though they can't make a great financial living out of it. But the love of the music and of the musicians carried Freddie Taylor all these years, and I'm talking about 80 odd years. Freddie was something else. He was one of a kind.
Thank you for that beautiful message, George Wein. And I too can't wait to read Fred Taylor's memoir. What? And Give Up Showbiz? How great is that title, by the way? So him. This is a gem. And if you'd like to pick one of your copies up, the link is in the description below. A portion of all the book sales will go to the Fred Taylor Endowed Scholarship Fund as well. Next up is a few words from the first scholarship recipient, Jessica Brown, followed by the current scholarship recipient, Jacob Stevens.
Hi, I'm Jessie. I recently graduated from Berklee. I got a dual major in music production engineering and music business management. And I'm also the first recipient of the Fred Taylor Scholarship. So, pretty exciting. I just wanted to take a second to say thank you to Grace and to Irene and Bob, because they, not only did they do this amazing event, made all of this happen, set up this wonderful fund for students years after me, I got the amazing opportunity to have a Thanksgiving meal with them right after we had met at the scholarship lunch. And I got to talk to Fred Taylor, and he is, like everyone has been saying, a national treasure, and he's done amazing things for the Boston music community. Thank you so much for everyone that's here, because of the scholarship, I was able to not take out student loans during my last semester. So, woohoo, less debt. This particular scholarship is so important at Berklee because it's a scholarship for students in their second or third or fourth year, so students that didn't get a scholarship when they auditioned. So thank you, everyone, for being here, and thank you, Irene, Bob, and Fred, and Grace. Thanks.
Thank you, Jesse.
Hello. My name is Jacob Stevens. I'm from New Orleans, Louisiana, and I'm a seventh semester majoring in music business, folks, and entrepreneurship. Throughout my years at Berklee, I've started my own record label and have been trying to find the best talent Berklee can offer. Starting my own company and going through the major has really been extremely helpful because I have been able to talk with my teachers and learn from their mistakes. Also, being at Berklee and being with some of the best musicians in the world, I've been able to talk with them and understand where they're coming from and be able to grow with them and be ready to take over the industry in the future. Receiving this award means the world to me because Fred Taylor was able to change the music industry. Learning from his example, I would like to do the exact same thing. This award will allow me to pursue my dream of empowering the artists to be able to have more ownership of their music. I would like to thank Irene Chang, Bob Kelly, and Grace Kelly for giving students like me the opportunity to receive this award and pursue my dream.
Ah, the students and their stories are so inspiring. Fred loved the idea of having a scholarship in his name that would keep his legacy alive. Fred was an only child and was never married, and this scholarship was a way for his name and legacy to live on, and it meant a lot to him to know the scholarship would impact many future generations of talented students in music performance and music business. As he said in his book, none of us can go on forever, but maybe with things like this, the music will. If you'd like to support the Fred Taylor Endowed Scholarship Fund, there is a link below and in the description to help keep on his legacy. After a long battle with cancer, Fred Taylor passed on October 26, 2019. There was a memorial service held for him at Levine Chapel in Brookline, Massachusetts. We want to share a few excerpts and tributes from some of his friends.
I want to say how happy Fred would be. Fred, we're sold out, man. Wouldn't he love to hear those words? The jazz guy, Fred Taylor. Fred once said in an interview, someone asked him how he got into the music business, and he said, everything is by accident. I didn't plan anything. Everything's by accident. Nothing goes by plan. But he did add, if I need to go to the bathroom, I'll plan that. Everything else happens by chance. He loved comics. Comedy, I think he would have been a great Bushbell comic because he booked a lot of comics. Erwin Corey and his clubs, Jan Murray, people like that. We talked endlessly about Jewish humor and how much it uplifted the world in times of crisis. And it was sort of an innate thing in the Jewish tradition to be humorous because it helped to kill the suffering. And Fred was, boy, you talk about somebody who could kill the suffering, it was Fred Taylor. Every time he walked into a place, you knew something was going to happen. And he was always there in the clubs to hear the musicians he booked. He didn't just walk out, he was there. And he appreciated great talent. And he respected new talent too and started so many people on the road to success. If I was here to mention them all, I'd be here all afternoon. What an important and unrivaled legacy Fred left to the city he loved, Boston, Massachusetts. A legacy that will live on with the Fred Taylor Berklee Scholarship Fund established in his memory by those friends who knew and loved him. So many friends who are here today for this memorial service to Fred Taylor. Thank you, Fred.
And some of the things that stick out in my mind were interviews conducted in Fred's office with Freddie Hubbard, with Herbie Hancock right after he left Miles Davis and formed a sextet that later became the Mwandishi Band. Fred was one of the first people to give him a gig. Seeing Thelonious Monk's last appearance in Boston as a band leader with a quartet that featured Governor Deval Patrick's father, Pat Patrick, playing tenor saxophone. Hearing, sitting in the corner so I could look directly at Tony Williams' two hands and two feet as he played with Lifetime, an experience I got to have yet again 20 years later at Scholars with Roy Haynes. Two of the most amazing evenings of my life, just watching these geniuses play drums. Hearing Miles Davis and strange noises coming from the stage from someone who I couldn't even see. And asking Dave Holland afterwards, who's making those noises? Oh, it's a guy from Brazil named Ayerto. Hearing Bobby Timmons reunited with Cannonball Adderley at Paul's Mall. Hearing Wynton Kelly reunited with Miles Davis briefly at the workshop. Duke Ellington appearing in Paul's Mall about 6 months before he passed away. And again, thank you, Fred, for giving me the opportunity to actually experience Duke Ellington live. I have to thank Fred for all these experiences. And the one comment Fred made that stands out to me. It tells us a lot about him. He said, "We elected to go with the times rather than hang on to what we might have been more comfortable with personally speaking, what we were more familiar with and grew up with." And he said this in a week when Jerry Garcia was playing at Paul's Mall, something that Fred might not have considered an appropriate booking 5 or 6 years earlier. But he was aware of changes. He was aware of the age of the audience changing. And I asked him about the success of the clubs at the time, and he said, "We have a unique complex in the perfect location. We've got Saks Fifth Avenue and Lord & Taylor across the street and Senior Pizza around the corner." And what he meant was he had found the one place in Boston at a time of incredible racial tension, if you recall the busing era, where everybody felt comfortable. He could attract young and old, black, white, brown, yellow, you name it. And everyone felt comfortable in a Fred Taylor club. And I think what he'd like to leave us with is for all of us amateurs who he's nurtured, that in lieu of flowers, and in addition to supporting his scholarship, we should all hear great music. And thank you, Fred, for all the great music that you allowed us to hear.
Speaking from a cultural point of view, I don't know how Fred Taylor can be replaced. I don't think he can be replaced. I think his impact was so much for these, he started the workshop in about 1960, and his time in the music business went back even further than that. I think his impact has been so heavy on the jazz, on the music community. Again, his commitment and love for music extended past the boundaries of jazz. It wasn't just a love for jazz. He loved music. I had a love for Fred because he was so real, so warm to everyone, and that warmth extended to everyone around him. I also mentioned, too, a number of promoters throughout the years who put on events, and I, as an African-American, I've spoken to them about the lack of African-American participation in their events. Fred, there was never a problem with Fred. His concerts were places where everyone took part. He booked a variety of folks into the club, and I always admired the fact that his wasn't just a blind eye selecting only white artists to come into the club, that he could see, he could hear the artists and bring the artists into the club based on the music that he was hearing. He could select artists to play based on what he was hearing and not thinking so much along color-conscious lines. I will never forget Fred Taylor, and none of us should forget Fred Taylor, because he did so much for the city. Someone posted on my Facebook page and said to me, "I'm sorry for your loss." And I said, "Yes, it's certainly a loss for me, but it's a loss for the cultural life of our city, too." Thank you very much.
You know, Fred is first and foremost and known as a jazz man. He's a Boston jazz man. He's an America jazz man, a world jazz man. But the man was multi-genre, as we all know. We were doing as many as 3 live broadcasts a week on BCN at that time, and we were not just rock and roll. So one night we'd have Betty Carter on. Another night we'd have Jack DeJohnette on. We had John Coltrane. But Fred booked and we broadcast the very first Boston performance by Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers. He was early on Bruce Springsteen. My first live broadcast with Fred was Bob Marley and the Wailers, a Rastafarian man. We did Patti Smith. And sadly, on my birthday, oddly enough, in 1978, we closed the club with B.B. King. You'll be hearing more of that in a moment. James Montgomery, who is here, showed up. Dee Dee Bridgewater was on the stage with B.B., and that was the closing of Paul's Mall and the Jazz Workshop. And one of my favorite memories was Scholars 2015, when Fred was being awarded Berklee's first Impresario Award. And on stage comes Fred and George Wein. Well, instantly the stage was transformed into a Borscht Belt scene. I mean, these two guys were a riot. They were like the 2015 Martin and Lewis or Brooks and Reiner. It was amazing. This past August, Fred told me, "Sam, I'm hanging in here till I get the book done." He told Hege and me in September that he wanted to be at Spalding Nursing in Alston because it's just a few blocks from my office. The man was indomitable, but not only indomitable about his love for and his life work in entertainment, he was indomitable, ceaselessly honest, an old school handshake businessman, and the truest of friends to so many of us. Literally hundreds of people lucky enough to know Fred. His ceaseless energy and work, especially in the last few years, had many people describe him as the Energizer Bunny. I would suggest, however, his boyish humor and joy that he spread all the time makes him the Energizer Bugs Bunny. I will leave you with Fred's own voice as I say, Fred Taylor is among the greatest, kindest, and yes, most fun-loving souls in the universe, now and always. Fred is with us.
Where's Freddy? Is he here someplace? He wanted me to tell you that it's not goodbye, it's just good night. There he is. Hey, Freddy.
Hey. Thank you, all you people, and for the years and for now. We sort of going out on a little bit of history, and it's beautiful Matt Siegel and WBCN, who have been such good friends over all the years, and we've done so many exciting things. And there's so many people that have come back tonight. It's just it's unbelievable. But I just want to say it couldn't be a better group, a better artist to go out with the blues, and that's so appropriate. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Boston. It's been a beautiful engagement.
It's been a beautiful engagement.
My life, such as it has been, things that have influenced me. You know, it's okay to, remember the past and things, but always have something going for you in the future. You've got to keep that forward momentum and don't get too caught in memory lane. I mean, memories are good and so forth, but don't get caught up and stay there. And that's sort of been a thing with me. I got to have something always that's ahead. You got something to do that you're looking forward to. And I think that's and of course music has been an incredible life force. The reason why I fudged my little 20th anniversary of my 70th birthday is I feel like some people say, well, oh, you're 90, and you gotta stop, No. That's merely, it's an anniversary. Now we're going on to the next thing. And I think that's so important. And it's like the guy says, hey, you can't take it with you. I said, well, I won't go. Anyways, those are my little words to you.